Where's Daddy?
He's coming.
Cord, push your red button.
Coach Mears, and so important to him that you're here. We want to tell you thank you. They're going to hear from many different folks today, but the most important thing is that you're here. Your love and support is a wonderful and a beautiful and a precious thing. And so we are at Concord High School. Say, woo! Woo! And yeah, there you go. And so I'm going to ask you if you can to stand with me, and we're going to listen to the Concord High School fight song. Let's stand up. Thank you, and thank you to the Spiderettes, to the many cheerleaders. Thank you so much. And you can be seated, and let's turn him around so he can see. We don't want to look at him. All right. You want to put him right beside us, Sue? And so keeping with this theme of honoring coaches' life, so many of you here have been personally impacted by him as an educator. And I'm old enough now that I've earned every white hair in my head. And I have a really, probably the same as you, but different than when I was in high school. I didn't know where I was. And one day I woke up, and I started realizing the impact of educators. So I'd say to every one of you here who taught, coach, that you've had an opportunity to impact at this point tens of thousands of people. And that's so wonderful and so appreciated that you have influenced people my age that now have families of their own, and it'll travel. The values and the things that you taught and the way you lived are so wonderful and valuable to us. And so we want to hear from some of Coach's peers, some of the men and women who worked for him, worked with him. And so right now we want to introduce to you the former principal here, and now principal of my oldest, or my youngest girl, Miss Carla Black. So would you give her a welcome, please?
Family and friends, I'm just honored to be here today. My first encounter with Mr. Mears, and I don't know if you remember this, is when I was teaching ninth grade English at Central Cabarrus High School and saw him coming down the hallway, and I thought, that's the sharpest dressed man I had ever seen in my life. Does he work here? Because no teachers I knew dressed like that. Usually they dress with the seasons or they wear athletic gear, but I just remember the warm welcome that you gave me and how kind you were to me. And I thank you for that. In education, I think it often gets missing in certain circles, not everywhere, that we forget that it's about relationships and people, and it's about the love and kindness that we show towards each other. So it's not about me today. I just want to honor people like you, and especially you, because you bring that everywhere you go. You share that to everyone and with everyone you meet, and that will never be forgotten. So I just wanted to give you this a little bit of sentiment from my heart to yours and to everyone here, because I'm sure you're all just happy that we're able to honor this man today. You know, I thank God for that. I thank God for that. There's a sweet, sweet spirit in this place, and I know that it's the spirit of the Lord. There's a sweet expression on each face, Spirit of the Lord. Sweet Heavenly Spirit, sweet Heavenly Dove, stay right here with us, filling us with your love. And for these blessings, we give you all the praise. Without a doubt, we know that we have been revived when we shall leave this place. Mr. Mears, Coach Mears, I love you. Thank you for the love that you show kids and people everywhere. And I just thank God for the sweet Holy Spirit that you share with those around you. And we honor you today. Thank you.
That's so beautiful, so wonderful. And now coming to speak is Coach Glenn Patton. Welcome, Coach.
Thank you. It's an honor, and it's very humbling to be here to salute you today, Coach Mears. My name is Glenn Padgett. I teach and coach here at Concord High School, and Coach Mears and I go back about 25 years. I think back to when I first met Mr. Mears. He was an assistant principal, and he was the athletic director at Central Cabarrus High School. And I was a young athletic director here at Concord High School, trying to wade my way through and learn the ins and outs of this job. And I can remember going to him for advice and at meetings when we had our South Piedmont Conference meetings. And I was always struck by, in every discussion that we ever had, whether it was as a conference or whether it was individually, I was always struck by his true care for young people and how he always had young people's minds and hearts premium in his own mind. And I think if you reflect back on his career and the things that he did in education, it truly is an honor to mention that to you. You know, I think of the time, I don't know if you remember this, but when you first came to Concord High School, you know, I remember hearing that Coach Mears was coming here from being an assistant principal and athletic director at Central. And when he first came in, and he was known for wearing these, Sue, I'm sure you remember this, these outlandish outfits. I mean, he would come in, and he probably still wears some of them to church, I'm guessing, but he would come in a bright, I remember one time he came in a bright green sport jacket, and I remember thinking, Coach, not here. I mean, anywhere else, not here. But he immediately endeared himself to the students here at Concord High School, to the faculty, to the football players, and all of the athletes, and all of the support that he's given over the years. You know, whenever he's able, and whenever Sue are able, they're at an athletic event here at Concord, a basketball game, a football game. And you know, I think back to when he first started that routine here. I remember one Monday he came in. Some of you may remember this. He came in and he had his arm in a sling. He was probably late 40s at the time. And I went, Coach, what happened to you? I mean, I'm curious. Thought he might have been in a car wreck or something. I don't know. So I was playing football with the kids. What? Always being active, always being around young people and being such a great influence on them. I remember when we came back to Concord in 2009, Coach Mears and his wife were still here, still supporting, still coming to every game. And one of the most touching things in my heart was being our first year here. And we were playing up in the mountains at a school called High Brighton High School. I will not tell you about the result of the game. It was bad. It was in the playoffs. And my mom, my late mother, and my father were sitting in the stands at the game. And after the game was over, of course, my mom, first thing she said, and they beat us like 40-6. The first thing was, I'm sorry, but I'm glad your season's over. Mom, not now. But then the second thing that she said was so endearing and so special to me. She said, I met the most amazing people in the stands tonight. I met Mr. Mears and his wife, and we talked about Waynesville, and we talked about, because my parents lived in, my dad still does live in Waynesville, and my mom, who had just met them, literally recognized their true specialness at that moment. And I think to you all, you being here is a salute to that specialness that you are. That you are, in so many ways, a Concord Spider through and through. In all the schools that Mr. Mears has been at working and attending and being a part of, his presence here at Concord High is special, not just to the coaches and the faculty, but our players. We've got some players here today. You didn't see them, but they snuck in the door. And they're here for you. They're here for you, and to honor Mr. Mears and to honor his legacy and what he means to this high school, to this community, to your church, to me, who is not a peer of Mr. Mears. I'm an admirer of Mr. Mears. And I think we're all here for that very same reason. And the last thing that I'd like to do is, this is something our players and coaches got this year. It's something that we're gonna wear with a lot of pride. And Coach Mears is just as much a part of that, if not more a part of that, than anyone else. So I love you and I salute you, and wouldn't be anywhere else in the world but right here, right now. Thank you.
What a wonderful tribute. Right now we'll hear our next speaker is Coach Clement Fleming. Please welcome Coach Fleming.
Good evening. It is an honor for me to be here today. In my 35-year career, I met a lot of interesting people, I'm telling you. And of course, it's amazing about the number of people you meet. And this champion of a person, Mr. Mears, is who I want to speak of. Working with him as an administrator, as an educator, the first thing you learned was he had the first thing in mind, and that was the child. His attitude, his communication, his pride, his supportive ways, was contagious. Because when you spent 1 minute with him, you knew what he was all about. It was about that child. I never forgot that. He always had this whatever it takes attitude. Whatever it takes to get this kid right, that's what we're gonna do. I remember so well going into his office one day. I was real disturbed with the young person. And of course he sat there and said, Coach, let's have it. Of course, I told him. During the time, he kind of coached me on and said, well, Coach, that's true. But when I finished, he looked at me and said, Coach, now with that being said, what's your point? That was Mr. Mears. You're a champion. That's the way I look at it. He always had this matter-of-fact attitude, personality, however you want to say it. And let me tell you, it was contagious. And Mr. Mears, I appreciate it. Mr. Mears also was a man that loved music. We shared a few artists, I think. One come to mind is Luther Vandross. Between that and his flashy dressing, that was it. He set standards for all of us. If you're looking for a true friend, that champion right sitting right there. Thank you, Mr. Mears.
tell you about that afro.
There's so many inside stories. If we tried to tell them all, it would take us 2 days to do it. One thing that that Coach Fleming mentioned was Coach Mears, Mr. Mears' love for music. And I think the first time I met him, he came to Central Cabarrus where I was, and we knew we were getting a new wrestling coach. And we hadn't seen him yet, and few of us guys were standing outside the gym one day, and it was a nice day. The sun was shining, and a car was coming down the street, and one of the boys said, "I believe that's the new wrestling coach." And I took a look at him. It was a green MG with the top down and music blaring. And I looked, and there was kind of a hippie-looking fellow with long, curly, dreadlock-looking hair and the music blaring, and I said, "No way." Little did I know, yes, way. And I knew from that moment that he loved music, and he loves all kinds of music. He especially loves some gospel music. And so right now, Brother Priestley Johnson is coming to sing one of his favorite songs. Come on, Brother Priestley. Would it be better for him to sing through this mic?
Whatever he wants.
I know they got Priestley Johnson to sing a song, but I asked my two daughters to bail me out here because they have my back. Thank you. Let's see. Did you stop to pray this morning as you started on your way? Did you ask the Lord to guide you, walk beside through the day? Did you think to pray this morning? Did you kneel one more moment today? All the skies will be blue, 'cause he's walking with you. If you just remember to pray, when you stop to pray, he'll answer. If your heart, he will speak to you, and you know the joy of talking with a friend so kind and so true. Did you stay to pray this morning? Did you kneel just one moment today? Walking
you just,
if you just remember to pray.
That's awesome. Priestley is an elder in our church, and his daughter's with him. I introduced them. They're coming back in a moment. But reminded me that when Coach, I heard him over there just a couple of times going, well, he loves that stuff. Right now, the next speaker is Coach's daughter, Flynn. And would you give her a welcome, please?
Hello, I'm happy to be here today. Thank you all for being here to honor my wonderful father. I really appreciate it. It means a lot. I'd like to start by reading a note from a very old and dear friend, Beecher Henderson. He's in Warrenton, North Carolina, and I believe you met Beecher when we moved to Warrenton for you to be principal at John Graham, is that right? Which was a long time ago because I was a tiny girl then, and I'm 47 now, so it's been a minute. John, enjoy your special day. Having you for a real friend for all of these years has been and is great. You have touched, I'm sorry, you have touched lots of lives, so keep it up. Sorry I can't be with you, but we'll get together soon. Hang in there, buddy, Beecher. And that's one of the most profound things about my dad. He has touched so many people's lives. And he's been an inspiration to me. I've seen how he has been, you know, all in with his work as an educator and a coach. And although I resisted being an educator, I actually did some of that and became a teacher, much to my surprise and his, although he probably said, I told you so, maybe. We've shared many special moments from the wrestling team, fellas, to football and backgammon by the fire and dancing and good food. And so I just want to say thank you, Daddy, and I love you.
The next speaker with some more words from family members and from her heart is Erin. Give her a welcome. Sure to tell you, this is the baby. This is the baby. Come on, Erin.
I love you, son. Okay, I am really not good at this, so y'all bear with me. The first thing I'm going to read is from my dad's nephew, Claude, who sent me this morning. I have a bit of a funny story and a few memories I'd like to share about my Uncle Kenny. When I was about 5, I was visiting my uncle and my family. Apparently, I hit my sister, Vicky. She probably stuck her tongue out at me or something. Anyway, I guess I hit her a number of times on that trip because he had told me the day before that I'd get a spanking from him if I ever hit her again. I remember spending an entire afternoon practicing running so he wouldn't be able to catch me when he got home from work. Needless to say, he caught me anyway, and I did get a spanking. I don't remember it being that bad. My mother's often told me that during our long car trip home, we passed a prison, and I said, Uncle Kenny should go there for spanking little boys. This story always makes me laugh and brings a smile to my face. Another vivid memory I have of my uncle was when my father, his big brother, died. So many people had been in and out of the house that first day, but Uncle Kenny showed up sometime after the sun went down. Considering he had to take a plane to get there, I take it he got to our house pretty fast. I remember I was very upset, but I hadn't really begun to mourn yet. That night, we both stood on the back porch of my home. He put his arm around me, and we both just looked up at the stars. He made me feel so safe on a day of so much uncertainty. There's so much more I could say, so many more stories I could share, but I think the most important thing I want everyone to know is how much I love my uncle and how much he means to me. Though my entire life we've spent many hundreds of miles apart, Uncle Kenny has always felt more like a third parent more than anything else. I regret I cannot be there in person today, but to my uncle, I want you to know I love you and I miss you, especially on your special day. Now for me. I grew up in Central, but when my dad moved here, I moved here too. And my sister will kill me for saying this, but when Central used to play Concord, I used to cross to the other side of the field. Because my dad was a fan of Concord and I was my dad's biggest fan. I still am my dad's biggest fan. He has been the most inspirational person I've ever met. He is the absolute best role model any person could ask for. And I was an adopted child, so he chose me and gave me a life that, from some stuff I've found out over the past week, I know I wouldn't have had if it wasn't for him. Thank you, Daddy. I love you.
How beautiful. Once again, we'll have Mr. Priestley Johnson and his daughters, Rochelle and Sabrina, come to see.
We just want to say, Coach, we love you. We appreciate you. Love lifted me. Love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me. Next speaker knows how to tease a preacher. He told me he would only speak for about 2 hours. And so, Coach Robbie Behringer, would you come on? speak a few words. Welcome, Coach Baker.
I thought the bomb of the program was always supposed to be at the front of the program. How do you follow that? John, we've been together a long time. I looked you up on Wikipedia today. I didn't realize you were born in 1756. And that you almost started a war between Britain and Spain. And that you built a Evangel Cathedral in Washington, D.C. in 1955. You've been around, buddy. I was a teacher for a few years at Central. I'm a Mount Pleasant boy. I got to get Mount Pleasant in, not all those Concord people. Mount Pleasant boy, Central gave me an opportunity to teach. And I was with a great faculty, great principal, M.L. Barnes. And John came, and I think that was the first year that we were in the new part of the building, the add-on, and they put me and you down at the very end of the hall, away from everybody. Little did I know that was intentional. I guess we lost the lottery that year. When John left, well, when I left before John did, to go back to Mount Pleasant. But John and I never lost contact. We visited each other. We called each other. And Than, I'm sorry, but we have gambled on the NCAA tournament every year since then. I tried to get him not to do it. It was bad, but he insisted. No, he did win a few times, but... Just the fact that he has remained my friend, because as a young teacher, he brought wisdom not just to the students, he brought wisdom to me. And we talked for hours many times about various things. And I've always been proud to have been his friend. I've always been proud that he has been in my life. And I know that his life has not always been full of fun. But he found a way to get through all of that. And he got with Sue, who I think was the perfect match. All of the children that John has amassed. Wonderful, wonderful kids. And I wish John nothing but the best, because he's a wonderful individual, and all the things that have been said by all these other wonderful people, I've seen that for a long, long time. He was oriented, and thankfully for me, he was teacher oriented too. He gave a lot of guidance to teachers, and especially a young whippersnapper like myself, except I'm not quite so young anymore. But John, all I can say is I love you. Sue loves you. Your family loves you. And I know God loves you.
You couldn't see it. I shouldn't have seen it. Coach is trying to pay his debt and his lost bets. His problem is he's really smart, but he bets on Maryland all the time. What you gonna say? Homeboys. But we're gonna hear from Coach himself, so I'm gonna bring you Coach and help you get right here and bring you a microphone.
Thank you.
stand, please? We're going to.
I didn't expect to be that. Thank you, Pat. First off, I want to make sure that I got some cousins from South Carolina, and they're right here, and I'd like to recognize them because Bonnie and Jimmy Cox. I'm part of the Mears, Cox, Graham family of Lower South Carolina. And if you've ever been to, Myrtle Beach, you've got to go right through Horry County and Lower South Carolina. So I appreciate those people being here today. And I appreciate everyone who's come. I want to thank you for being a part of it. I want to say it's nice to see Robbie and Rocky and Kenyon down there. And I'm real proud of the cheerleaders and the students that I've come contact. And somebody has made a point that they've learned a lot from me. But I can learn more from these students, these kids. They have helped me to be a better person. And so I want to thank every person that I have come in contact with, teachers, students, family, or whatever, who've been a part of my life. I want to tell you, though, that none of that will pale to my sweet, sweet wife, Sue. And I have said this whenever I get an opportunity. She has been my lover. She's been my friend. She's been my financial advisor. She's been my spiritual life. She's been my everything. She's been with me. When I had my stroke in 1995, she's been with me. She's been with every doctor, everything in the world. You could never, ever ask for a better soulmate. And if you got one, you better hold on to them for the rest of your life, because I am a very, very blessed man to have her in my life. Now, I want to pass this on. Robbie and everybody and Coach Clement and everybody I talked to and everything, what I believe in, and this is so important for Concord, for our society, and yes, I'm going to preach a little bit here, but I've always believed that we need to develop a win-win situation in our life. Now, people, listen to me. If you adopt a win-win attitude, your life is going to go a lot smoother. And I have always instilled in my students and my faculty members and everything like that to do a win-win situation. And you'll be surprised how much more with your sincerity and this attitude. If you say to a parent, we're on the same win-win situation, your child. We want your child to be a win-win. We want you to be a win-win-win. I want to become a win-win. You are to become a win-win. If we are on the same wavelength, struggling to be a win-win situation, just think what we could do in this whole universe if we as human beings develop a win-win attitude. That's my preaching for today. So again, I'd like to thank you all for coming. I'd like to thank Pastor for being MC for all this. And I guess I turn it back to you now, Pastor. Is that it? Or?
Made this day really special, and we've already mentioned Coach has a, if you want to come on, Coach has a lot of different musical taste, and he asked for these songs to be sung today, and right now he's got an old album that's in his house that is a Bob Dylan album, and you wouldn't usually put Bob Dylan with church music. But he wrote a song called I'm Saved, and Coach wanted y'all to hear that song today. So let's listen.
I just want to thank the Coach. I didn't get to know him real well like some of you had working with him, but he was my wrestling coach, and as Flynn mentioned, Flynn was a mat maid at that time, and this the impact. I didn't know the Lord at that time, but this the impact that Coach has on you as a mentor. And I'm looking back now and thinking he was always trying to get me to do the right thing, and he was always encouraging. And thank you, Coach. And this song talks about being saved, and y'all, everybody knows Coach is a Christian and he loves the Lord, and you know we're saved by the blood of the Lamb. That's what this song says. It also testifies that I was born already ruined, and so let's sing this song. It says saved.
was blinded by the devil, born already ruined. Stone cold deadhead as I stepped out of the womb. By his grace I have been touched, by his hand I have been healed. By his spirit I've been delivered, by his spirit I've been sealed. And I'm saved by the blood of the Lamb. I've been saved by the blood of the Lamb. Saved.
Hallelujah.
Say,
because I'm so glad to see it.
I'm so
I was going down for the last time, by his grace I have been spared. Not by works, by faith in him alone. For so long I've been hindered, for so long I've been stoned. I'm saved
by the blood of the Lamb. Saved by the blood of the Lamb.
Sing it out.
I've been saved.
Bob Dylan quite like that. Coach knows about it. He'll tell you about it. Well, we're going to have a few more moments together. There are refreshments that will be right behind me. You'll just come down the side and go back. And time to have just a bite of food and to shake hands and maybe reminisce a little longer. And this has been a beautiful day because you've made it that way and because we're talking about John Mears and a wonderful, wonderful man.
And so I felt like he might want to say a prayer for all of you. You've been so kind to him today. And when I asked him about it, he said, I'll think about it. And he did what he usually does. He got his sidekick here. He said, I'm going to defer to her in matters. And so Sue is just going to speak a blessing over all of you. And then after that, we'll have Coach back here. Let us put him back and come back and see him and spend some time with him. Yeah, put him in the back.
Okay, just want to tell one story. Many years ago, John, anyway, he learned to know a lot of people. And he learned about this fella that was living in Farmington, Missouri, on the internet. Da-da-da. Fine. Well, one day he said, what do you think about going to Farmington, Missouri? And I said, okay. So we'd never seen this fella before. His name was Andrew. And we got there, anyway, we learned about Andrew, and then later on his wife died, and we went to the funeral and whatnot. And after the funeral, we went to the house, and we decided to order pizza. Pizza, okay? Well, they asked John to say the blessing before they ate the pizza. And John, of course, he deferred to me. So I stood up, and John, we'd have to hold hands at family reunions, anyway, when we eat at home. Everybody has to hold hands, so you're all going to stand and hold hands when I pray. But this lady was there, and she was a cousin from Knoxville, Tennessee. And so I blessed the food, you know, and blessed the family, and just did my little prayer. And afterwards, she said, Sue, you don't attend a Baptist church, do you? And I said, no, I don't, because theirs is non-denominational. And she said, I didn't think so, because usually they don't call on women to pray in a Baptist church. Okay, but you know, it's okay. But anyway, but thank you so much. Oh my goodness, this means so much to John and to me. And I'm a crier, and usually I defer my praying to my younger sister that's here. But today I'm going to pray. So if you all stand and hold hands like you're a family, and look at the people on your right, and look at the people on your left, and just remember, if you don't like them today, they're going to be in heaven with you. So you better like them today, okay? Okay, let's bow our heads. Thank you, Lord, for this day. Thank you, God, for all the many, many blessings that you've given us, Lord. We're so undeserving, but you are deserving, God, and we thank you for that. Lord, I thank you for this day. I thank you for all the friends, all the relatives that are here today. Lord, and I just bless you because you're so good to us. Lord, I thank you and I praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
Can I get you to wait just a minute? And can I ask the cheerleaders to just make a tunnel right here on the other side of that wire? And we're going to push Coach through and take him through the tunnel. One more time.
One more time.
One more time. Go back and see him and enjoy some fellowship. Let's put our hands together. All right. Being here. Thank you for everyone that helped. Come back and have some fellowship and some food with us, and we'd love to see you. Bless you.
I'm just gonna.
They were taking pictures.
Is he gonna be greeting people? I don't want to get the back though. Let me see if there's another.
Hey Claire, come here. Thank you.
Y'all make sure you Yeah.
need to go home. You want to get on there?
Is it right past the Lone Star?
Yeah.
Okay.
Like a, well, if you...
Oh, that's nice. That's good.
Hey, buddy.
He's cheering.
PGA.
He gave away almost all his tokens to other kids there.
Oh, okay. So,
I mean, even